So T-cell development is happening in what I call the thymus, which is an epithelial organ, which is fine until sexual maturity, and then it involutes. Actually, because it involutes so much when you have stress, anatomists didn't realize that this was an important lymphoid organ, because when they sectioned patients that had just died, and usually this death was very stressful, the thymus involutes and the lymphoid cells in the thymus die from apoptosis. And so therefore, anatomists didn't have an idea about this lymphoid organ about a long time, until somebody clever, like in the 60s, like Jack Miller from Australia, he removed the thymus surgically from neonatal mice, and then he realized that these mice had an enormous defect in immune responses, so they couldn't reject skin grafts, for instance. He could graft them the skin of a chicken, and they would accept it. So there were these mice that were running around with feathers, and people thought that was very funny. But it was the effect of removing the source of T cells in these mice, and therefore the immune system had only B cells, and B cells by themselves can't do very much. So what happens in the thymus? So the thymus, as I said, it's a juicy organ until sexual maturity, and it's colonized by immature cells from the bone marrow. We do not exactly know how these cells look like. We still don't know. But we know they come from the bone marrow, and they're immature. And they are signified here by this arrow. And then, once they are in there, they start to rearrange their receptor gene loci in order to make T-cell receptors. And they come in two flavors. One is the alpha-beta T-cell receptor, for which you here have the TCR-beta gene, and they have the gamma and delta T-cell receptor, for which you here have the gamma and delta genes. The TCR-alpha pairing with this one rearranges later, and so it's not indicated here. So initially you have these cells undergoing rearrangement, and sometimes this rearrangement is productive and sometimes it's not. If it is productive, about one third of the case, then you produce, when you have the TCR-beta rearrangement, you have a TCR-beta protein, a TCR-beta chain, which then pairs with another chain, which is called the pre-T-cell receptor chain, which is also made by these cells, but not by rearrangement. That is just a gene that is active in immature cells, but not in mature cells. And as a result, these cells then express on the cell surface what is called now the pre-T-cell receptor, which consists of the TCR-beta chain paired with the pre-TCR-alpha chain. Well, that is a receptor which you only find on immature thymocytes. And this receptor actually does not bind to any ligand. It just needs to be expressed on the cell surface, and then the cell knows it has made a productive TCR-beta rearrangement, and it will be selected for further maturation. So it will undergo proliferation, and then express CD4 and CD8 on the cell surface, and become these cells there in the middle. Now, once you have these cells there, the TCR-alpha locus rearranges, as indicated on top. The PT-alpha, the pre-TCR-alpha disappears, that gene is silenced. And these cells then express the alpha-beta T-cell receptor. Now that is a receptor which is present on mature T lymphocytes in the periphery. And they come again in two flavors. One is the alpha-beta receptor on CD4 cells. So CD4 cells, they are making cytokines and help B cells to produce antibodies, but they do not kill other cells. So that is one type of cell which is generated, and then you have another cell which is generated expressing a different alpha-beta T-cell receptor, and these cells have the capacity to kill or lyse other cells that are virus infected, for instance, and eliminate those from the system. So these are the two major subsets of alpha beta T cells. I will in the end discuss another one, which are the so-called regulatory T cells, which also express this particular receptor. As I said, when the rearrangement of gamma and plus delta is successful, then you generate T cells which express the gamma delta T cell receptor. These cells have a relatively short intratimic lifespan, and they migrate from the thymus immediately and go to various organs like the epithelium and the gut. The function of these cells is not very well known, except that they are involved in the repair of skin lesions, and that's why the industry that is interested in skin repair, like famous French manufacturers of perfume and so forth, they are very much interested in these cells because they keep the skin intact. And they will support, actually, research on gamma delta T cells where nobody else does. So it's only the French industry that supports research here. Whereas this research on alpha beta T cells, that's supported by a large variety of different agencies, including the NIH, which provides research grants for this research. Now, the story, as usual, when you go into the detail, is a little bit more complex, because these first subsets of cells, where I said this undergoes T cell receptor rearrangement, actually consists of four distinct subsets which have each different surface markers indicated on the very top. So it starts with cells that are CD44 plus and CD25 minus. Then it goes to cells that cycle and are CD44 plus, 25 minus. Then it goes to the resting stage again. So these cells do not cycle. And these cells express the PTCR alpha gene, which then pairs with the PTCR beta chain. And that induces proliferation again. And then the cells change their phenotype again. They become CD44 minus, CD25 plus. And then TCR alpha rearrangement sets in. And these cells then become what we call double positive cells, CD4, CD8 positive. These are all surface markers to which we have antibodies, which you can buy very expensively from companies making these antibodies for you. And then we have further maturation, as I discussed. Now, after this stage here in development, this proliferation is driven by general cytokines, namely stem cell factor and IL-7, while from here on, when you express the pre-T cell receptor, then these cytokines are not important any longer, and growth and differentiation is regulated by the pre-T cell receptor and no longer by the general cytokines. Now, this is a picture of what the pre-T cell receptor could look like. This would be the pre-TCR alpha chain, while this would be the TCR beta chain. And you see that this guy sort of has an asymmetric picture, whereas, you know, the alpha beta TCR look perfectly symmetrical. And people who like symmetry don't like this picture, but people who are involved in structural analysis have found out that this TCR beta chain really rests on itself and is stable even without the pre-TCR alpha chain. And so therefore this is the receptor as it is expressed on immature thymus cells when they undergo maturation. There's also a splice form where this extracellular domain of the pre-TCR alpha chain is missing. And the function of the splice form is basically unknown, but likely it represents simply a device to make this here, it's a dominant negative, to make this here the rare functional receptor that is really important in development. Now, This receptor, as I told you, is unusual in that it doesn't bind to a ligand like what most other receptors do. And if you label it with biotin on the cell surface, then you and you keep your cells for 2 hours, you see that most of this receptor has disappeared, has been internalized. So it has disappeared from the cell surface. These are diagonal gels where you first run your gel under non-reducing conditions and then reducing conditions, and therefore the sulfate linked receptor comes off the diagonal and forms these two spots. And as you can see, in 2 hours these two spots have disappeared, so they have been internalized inside the cell. If you do the same experiment with the alpha beta T cell receptor, then you see the result is different. After 2 hours, the receptor is still on the cell surface and can still be detected by this gel analysis. So this receptor apparently signals ligand independently because this is on cultured cells and disappears within a very short time period. And when you look where it goes, then you realize it goes to the endosomal compartment because it co-stains with the endosomal compartment. So it's like the normal receptor that when it binds to ligand, it will be endocytosed and go into the endosome. This receptor does it without the ligand. It just spontaneously aggregates and goes into the endosome. And that is very consistent with its function, because its only function is to indicate to the cell you have made a productive TCR-beta protein. And once you have made this, you are ready for further differentiation, and therefore you can go on and become a more mature T-cell. If you look at the signaling by this receptor, it is really not different at all from the signaling of the mature alpha-beta T-cell receptor. It is associated with signal transducing CD3 molecules, and it involves the Src kinases, and it involves the adapter protein LAD and others. And so it's really a mirror of this signaling by the mature T-cell receptor. What is the function of this T-cell receptor apart from moving cells into the further differentiation? Well, it is a process which is called allelic exclusion. You know that in the immune system, and in B cells, for instance, one B cell expresses only one allele of the immunoglobulin heavy chain and one allele of the immunoglobulin light chain. And that's called allelic exclusion. And Fred Ault, who is another fellow at Harvard, has a long time ago proposed a model how this is going to happen. Number one would be that you have an asynchronous rearrangement of the receptor loci. So one rearranges before the other. And then, as the second mechanism, you have a feedback inhibition. That means when you have made a productive rearrangement, you will have a feedback on the other allele, so that the other allele does not rearrange any further and is maintained, either in germline configuration or in a configuration that is non-productive. And so we tested whether this model would apply to our pre-T cell receptor. And normally what you find in mature alpha-beta T cell is that 60% have one productive rearrangement, whereas the other one is in germline configuration. And 40% have on the other allele a productive rearrangement and on the second allele a non-productive rearrangement. That you can figure out yourself in a mathematical model according to what I told you that should happen. And that is what you find. Now, if you knock out the pre-T cell receptor, either by knocking out the PT-alpha gene or a gene downstream of the pre-T cell receptor, which is SLIP76, then you find that this ratio, which is normally 60 to 40, is changed to 40 to 60. In other words, now you have more cells that have made two rearrangements on both alleles. And then when you look at the cells that have productive rearrangements, then you find there's an increase in the proportion of cells that have two productive rearrangements from less than 5% to about 30%. So that proves that this receptor actually is involved in allelic exclusion by this mechanism proposed by Fred Ault a long time ago. So you have asynchronous rearrangement and feedback inhibition once you have made a productive rearrangement. Now, as I said, the pre-TCR also rescues cells with productive TCR-beta rearrangement because otherwise you can't make the receptor. And then these cells will go further, and you can ask the question, what is required for this signaling? And so there have been various attempts to find that out. What is important in the pre-TCR-alpha protein that conveys this spontaneous signaling properties? And the research there is not concluded yet. There will be further experiments. But it is clear that the transmembrane portion can help, and that the cytoplasmic tail can help, as well as the extracellular domain can help. We think that maybe that is conserved in various species. And we think the story is not yet concluded, which is the most important. It's clear that other parts of the protein contribute as well, but whether these contributions are essential and crucially important, that's not clear at present. So there is still research to be done. Actually, this research is being done by another fellow from St. Petersburg. His name is Michael Gleimer. He went to school here, but then he migrated to Canada, and he is now a postdoc in my lab, and he is investigating the role of this transmembrane part. So I have two Russian postdocs, both very smart and very much welcome in the lab. Now, it has been found in the past that for this transition from the immature to the more mature stage in T-cell differentiation, you need not only the signaling of the pre-T-cell receptor, but you also need signaling of Notch. Now, Notch is a protein that is expressed in Drosophila, so it's evolutionarily very much conserved. And in this case, particular case, Notch has been identified as a protein that is involved in the survival of the cells. And Taras was interested to find out whether it's also essential for proliferation and differentiation, which was not known at that time. So how did he do that? Well, since he is smart, he said, first we have to replace the function of Notch in survival, and he did this by overexpressing of BCL2, which is a survival gene, in these cells. So these cells would die very quickly in culture, and at day 8, without Notch signaling, you would hardly have any cells left to work with, and that is of course bad. When you don't have anything to work with, you cannot check whether there is any other function but survival. But when you express the BCL2 transgene under the promoter of VAF, then you can see that this helps very much the survival of cells in culture, and you have plenty of cells here after day 8 where you can now test whether Notch is doing something else in addition to making the cells survive. And so that's what Taras did. And the short answer is that when you take these cells in culture, now with the VAF BCL2 transgene, and you culture them in the absence of Notch signaling, you still have plenty of cells, as I told you before, to look at, then you can see they fail to differentiate in the absence of Notch signaling. Here, Notch has been replaced by GFP. Whereas in the presence of Notch signaling, where you have the appropriate ligand for the Notch receptor, then you have differentiation and the cells become double positive, CD4 and CD8 double positive. So that indicates that Notch signaling is not only required for survival, but it's also required for proliferation. And that shows you the same thing simply by looking at the dilution of the CFSE labeled E label of the cultured cells, and you can see in the absence of Notch signaling, these cells do not divide at all. In other words, they do not dilute the CFSE label, whereas in the other cases they do because they are dividing. Now, downstream of Notch signaling, people know that, there is c-MYC, and c-MYC is very well known to be involved in proliferation. So if you knock out c-MYC as done here, clearly c-MYC is essential for this proliferation of Notch signaling. But when you overexpress c-MYC as a transgene, it cannot replace Notch signaling. In other words, c-MYC is required, but is not essential or sufficient to drive proliferation of developing thymocytes. And that's synergized here, that yes, you need Notch signaling, and that is sufficient and required for proliferation. You require also c-MYC, but c-MYC by itself is insufficient to drive proliferation. Now, most of the proliferation of cells in the time is actually occurs after they express the pre-T-cell receptor. There's a good reason for this, because here you have now a single TCR-beta chain on these expanded cells that now will be able to combine with various TCR-alpha chains, because TCR-alpha chain rearrangement is setting in at this point, and then each of these single TCR-beta chain from this expanded cell can combine with a different TCR-alpha chain. So this is a mechanism which helps generating you a diverse repertoire. Now, Taras again was wondering whether this proliferation actually was essential prior to the rearrangement of TCR-alpha and becoming a double positive cell. And that was a very legitimate question, because what I just told you, you need this proliferation or generate diversity. And he also noticed that when he labeled these cells, these developing thymocytes with CFSE, that the cells that express CD4 and CD8 were almost among the most divided cells, because this here is a dilution of CFSE, and the most divided cells and express CD4 and CD8. So he followed this up and asked the question, is proliferation required for double positive? And here is what he did in order to test this. He got inhibitors by collaborating with the cell cycle guy. That's another advantage of Harvard. You have a very competent faculty, and if you need some reagent, you just go next door and ask for it, and usually you get it. So, in this case, he went to a cell cycle guy, and his name is Peter Zizinski, from Poland, actually, another from East Germany, who is full professor in Harvard. And he got this inhibitor, and as you can see, when you treat cells with an inhibitor, you do not have any cell division. Actually, you can wash out the inhibitor and culture the cells again, and then you will have cell division. The question is, does that block differentiation into double positive cells? And as you can see, it does. The cells do not developmentally progress when their cell cycle is inhibited, whereas the cells that have been washed out and are free of the inhibitor, then they progress and become double positive cells. So that's one of many experiments which we did where he showed that cell cycle proliferation or division is required in order for differentiation. Here he used a different method to block proliferation, namely thymidine, and got very much the same result. In other words, when you inhibit cell cycle progression by this independent drug, you do not differentiate further whereas in the absence of such inhibitor, you do. So he made his point with two totally different inhibitors of cell cycle progression and got the same result. And then in this experiment here, he asked the question, how many divisions are actually required to be able to progress developmentally? And his conclusion is you need about 4 cell divisions, and then you can progress developmentally and become a more mature thymocyte. So as I said, very good, and it's actually the first type of this work where this has been reported. Strangely, proliferation versus differentiation in the thymus has never been conclusively addressed by good studies. And it looks to me like you need to have a faculty like you have in Harvard, where you just go next door and ask the guy, can you help me with a drug that does this and this? And usually you get a positive answer and you can do the experiment immediately. So that's the advantage of working at Harvard. And Tars took advantage of it. He then went further and made a so-called proliferator construct, where he had various cyclines separated by short pieces of intervening sequences that should be expressed, and he transfected thymocytes, asking the question whether when he drives proliferation by this cell cycle construct, does he get differentiation without signaling of the pre-T cell receptor, for instance. And the answer clearly is yes, this is a proliferator construct, you get proliferation, but you do not get differentiation into double positive cells. In other words, proliferation is not enough in the absence of pre-TCR signaling, but in the meantime, he has done the same experiment in the absence of notch signaling, and there it works. You can override the function of notch by simply inducing proliferation in the developing thymocytes, and then they will become developmentally more progressed. So it seems that a very important function of notch is not only survival, but is to induce proliferation in these developing T cells. And once you do that, then they can developmentally progress. So that would be the conclusion from this type of work. Now here we address something different, namely discrepancy between the lab of Diane Matthys and Christophe Benoit, also at Harvard in our lab, on the role of CD8 alpha-alpha cells in TCR transgenic mice. I will later come on and tell you some experiments which we did in TCR transgenic mice in order to address certain questions. And it became clear that when you made these TCR transgenic mice, you had abnormal TCR expressing T cell subsets. And the question then arose, what are these cells? In a way, they were an artifact. But sometimes it's even important to find out what artifacts are due to. And so we did this in collaboration with Dan Littman in New York, who had developed a beautiful lineage fate mapping approach, which for that very purpose I included in my talk here, not because these experiments are extremely important, but because this system is extremely important. And what he has is actually a fluorescent dye, YFP, which is preceded by a stop codon, so usually it's not expressed. But once you remove this stop codon, this can be expressed, and then every cell that expresses this YFP has been a cell derived from a cell where the stop codon has been removed. And you can remove this stop codon, for instance, by Rho Gamma T Cre. So Cre is an enzyme that cuts these signal sequences here and removes the stop codon. And Rho Gamma T actually is a gene that is expressed in double positive T cells and has important functions in the gut, which I don't want to discuss here. Just this approach, so if you treat mice with Rho Gamma T Cre, then every cell that has been double positive and has been removed, the stop codon expresses YFP and therefore must have been derived from a double positive thermostat. And so this model was used by and co-workers, and actually so when you have this stop codon removed, then these cells will all have fluorescent and therefore will be derived from double positive cells, because Rho gamma T is only expressed from that stage onwards and not before. Okay? And when you look now at these unusual cells in the bone marrow and look at the more conventional cells, then you find that all these conventional cells, which are indicated here, they show that they actually are derived from double positive thymocytes, as most alpha beta T cells are. But these unusual cells in TCR transgenic mice, they are not, they are an artifact of too early expression of the alpha beta TCR, and the cells are fooled and arrest differentiation and do not go further because they already express a pre-TCR, a T-cell receptor, which they normally would only do much later. So these cells are transgenic artifacts, which you should not let you confused by, because they do not exist in normal mice. So that was an important conclusion from that experiment, because many people have argued about these artifacts. And so Taras, together with the Lippmann lab, settled that question too, and that has been published and has been appreciated by the scientific community. Now, then he asked a more difficult question, namely, what makes the decision whether you become a gamma delta T cell or an alpha beta T cell? And as a non-informed scholar of immunology, you would think it's of course a receptor. If you have a gamma delta receptor, you become a gamma delta cell. If you have an alpha beta receptor, you become an alpha beta cell. But that is not true, because there are mice that express only gamma delta TCR, because they express these transgenes on a background where endogenous genes cannot rearrange. So the only receptor these poor mice can make is a gamma delta T cell receptor. They cannot make a pre-TCR, they only can make a gamma delta TCR, but these mice do contain double positive T cells, which we think belong to the alpha beta lineage. In addition to these cells that look like typical gamma delta T cells. So that indicates that the class of the receptor does not determine the lineage fate. In other words, if you express a gamma delta TCR, you still have a chance of becoming an alpha beta T cell. Why is that? What determines the lineage fate then? And the answer to this, I don't want to go too many details, but the answer to this is that it depends on the strength of the signal provided. We have gamma delta T cell receptors that give a strong signal. Whether it is ligand dependent or ligand independent is still debatable. But it is clear that some signal strongly, some signal more weakly. The more weakly signaling gamma delta T cell receptor cells can still go into the alpha beta lineage, can still rearrange alpha and beta genes and become a typical alpha beta T cell. So it's signaling strength rather than the class of the receptor which decides whether you become a gamma delta cell or alpha beta lineage cell. And that's shown here by this experiment, by these people here. That is when they have a strong ligand to the T cell receptor, then the only type of cell you get is the gamma delta T cell receptor, which is double negative, doesn't express CD4 and CD8. Whereas in the absence of the ligand, just having the receptor, many of these cells become double positives and enter the alpha beta lineage and can rearrange alpha and beta and can end up as a typical alpha beta T cell. So these experiments, which we have confirmed in the lab, suggests that the strength of signaling is important. But then, that is not the entire story, because you can say the strength of signal is instructive. On the top is when you have a strong signal, you go to the gamma delta lineage. If you have a wimpy signal, you go to the alpha beta lineage, but you can also envisage a more complicated model where the cell is committed to either fate, and if it has received a strong signal, it needs a further strong signal in order to persist. Whereas it doesn't receive a further strong signal, it will die. And these experiments which I just told you in bulk culture, they cannot decide whether this model or this model is correct, because you can easily miss the few dying cells in culture, and then you don't know what happens. So Taras, again, a clever man, said that can only be addressed by single cell experiments, because once you have a single cell, then you can very well tell whether the progeny of that cell will die or will survive. So what he did is he used the cell sorter to separate single cells that express the gamma delta GCR. And then he cultured them, and then he gave them a strong signal by adding a gamma delta TCR antibody, which does further cross-linking of the gamma delta T cell receptor. And that would be cells receiving a strong signal, while other cells from the same well, because he is splitting the well, he made one cell here, there are several cells here, and then you can split the well and you can do this split well analysis. And the result is the following. Most T cells that have a gamma delta TCR are those that, even in the presence of a strong signal, do not become alpha beta cells. And even if you leave out the cross-linking antibody, all they generate is gamma delta T cells. That is a majority, about 70%. But then there are those cells here that, in the absence of a strong signal, clearly become double positive cells. But if you give a strong signal, then that is inhibited, and the cells are prevented from becoming alpha beta lineage cells. So that experiment tells you that the lineage decision is made after the receptor is expressed on the cell surface, and it depends on the intensity of the signal, whether the cell is going this way or the other way. That's an important conclusion, because when you look at the textbooks tell you it's the class of the receptor which decides which way the cell is going. These textbooks are wrong, like most textbooks are. And Taras did the right experiment, and he has shown that even when you already express a receptor, the lineage fate can still be decided depending on whether this receptor strongly or weakly signals. And that is a very important conclusion with regard to lineage fate, which is sort of at the forefront of interest in cell biology, because you really want to know what is required to make this or the other lineage. And so he made an important contribution there. But now I want to discuss, so these were relatively early steps in T-cell development, where you have alpha beta versus gamma delta lineage decisions. And now I want to come to experiments which are addressing later stages of T-cell to help antibody production. You don't want to help a cell to kill the antibody-producing cell. That would be idiotic, right? And usually the helper cells are class 2 MHC restricted, so they recognize foreign antigen presented by class 2 MHC molecules. If you haven't heard about MHC restriction, then you have to blame this on Rolf Sinkernagel, which is my colleague in Zurich, because he got a Nobel Prize for it, so you should know about it, but if you don't, I don't blame you. And then the other cell which you're making is a CD8 cell, which actually can kill cells. And that's an important cell, because once a B cell has been infected with virus and the virus is multiplying within that cell, you want to get rid of this cell, because that cell supports the survival of the virus in the body. So you have this dichotomy of class 1 restricted and class 2 restricted T cells. The class 2 restricted cells help, they make cytokines. The class 1 restricted cells kill, and actually they look at antigens that come from the inside of the cell that are presented that goes through the cytosol when I'm present on the cell surface, whereas the helper cells, they look at antigens that come into the cell from the outside by endocytic receptors, and are just then re-expressed on the cell surface. So the route of antigens is different when these two classes of cells recognize antigen. And as you can imagine, of course, virus replicates inside the cell. So this would be cytosolic antigens, whereas antigens like streptococcus, whatever, toxin, will enter the cell from the outside. And you want to make antibodies against it, and there will be a different story. So one versus class 2 presented. And we know that these antigens have different pathways within the cell. And so to do this, we looked at mice that express a transgenic receptor. But before we go into this, I should alert you of an abnormality of TCR-alpha locus, because in the TCR-alpha locus you do not have allelic exclusion, as it indicated here. 70% of mature T cells have one productive rearrangement, while 30% have two productive rearrangements. So these cells do not observe the rule of one cell, one receptor, as postulated by Burnett and other people. Of course, these people then didn't know this, but it's clear now that these cells here, you have the potential of making two different, one cell with two different receptors on the cell surface, and they do exist in the body, and they do not pose a terrible problem. But that has something to do where T and B cells differ, because in B cells, you have a very nice mechanism which has been exploited by many people, which is called receptor editing. In other words, when you have a B cell that makes an immunoglobulin receptor that is specific for cells, then this receptor signals and stimulates the cell to keep on the RAG genes that make a rearrangement. And these RAG genes then are responsible for the fact that the cell is making a new receptor, rearranges further, makes a new receptor, which then hopefully is non-cell, and then the cell can join the peripheral pool of B lymphocytes. That is totally different in immature T cells, because if they are making a receptor which is specific for self, they will be killed, they will be lysed and disappear from the system. There is no receptor editing in T cells. It's only restricted for B cells. Okay. Now, I explained. We took advantage of a kid mouse that has a rearrangement defect because of a genetic defect in the RAG enzyme, and so it cannot productively rearrange its own receptor genes. And if you provide such a poor beast with transgenes for an alpha beta T cell receptor of non-specificity, you will generate a mouse that has only one receptor instead of 10 to the 8. And that facilitates, of course, your analysis very much, because now you can breed that mouse with one receptor, the specificity of which you are aware, and ask the question, what happens to these cells in various environments? And that's done here. So if these mice are bred to other mice that do not have the appropriate MHC to which this receptor is restricted, then these cells will not develop further. They will all die at an immature stage. So they are not selected. They are selected against, if you want so. It's almost like Darwinian selection. Now, if these mice express the appropriate MHC but lack the peptide to which the receptor is specific, then these cells are selected, and they are all selected. This is a receptor that comes from a CD8 cell, and look what happens is that all the selection happens into the CD8 compartment, no selection into the CD4 compartment. So the specificity of the receptor for class 1 or class 2 determines whether the cell is going to become a CD8 cell or a CD4 cell. in the absence of the peptide. So presumably these are low affinity interactions which determine where the cell is going. And if the MHC molecule is not the right one, the cell is not going anywhere. And this is the case when you have both the peptide present and the appropriate MHC. That means now you have a high affinity ligand, and that leads to premature death of all these tiny cells. And so these cells never make it to the periphery, and so they cannot become harmful at the periphery. So that explains simply, in very simple experiments, what happens in time of selection. So the MHC molecules do select whether you become CD4 or CD8. You can do the same experiment with the CD4 restricted receptor, and that has been done. And then you get only CD4 cells and no CD8 cells. This selection only happens in the absence of the peptide ligand, which is recognized by the T cell receptor. If you have the peptide ligand and the appropriate MHC, then that will mean the end of the cell will die and disappear from the system. And again, I don't want to go too much through these experiments, but our colleague at NIH, Ron Germain, has shown that actually this lineage fate decision depends very much on the strength of the signal rather than on this, the signal per se. In other words, if you have a strong signal, you become a CD4 T cell. If you have a weak signal, you become a CD8 T cell. If you have no signal, you become no T cell. Okay? So that's what happened in the thymus. And actually, 99% of all thymocytes which we are producing when we are young are totally useless. They live 3 days and then they die very quickly. Now, pathologists never believe this because they haven't seen any evidence for necrosis. But then these pathologists didn't know about apoptosis. And all these cells in the thymus, they do die by apoptosis and are engulfed by other cells. And therefore, you don't see much evidence for necrosis in the thymus. And therefore, the modern pathologists are more inclined to believe the immunologists than the old guard of pathology. Just on the sideline here. Now, actually, there is somebody at NIH who I think is very close to a genius. Actually, that's Alfred Singer. And he has devised a model which explains all these things very well. And what he argues is you have these double positive cells that have the alpha beta T cell receptor. These cells have not undergone yet selection. The receptor binds to class 1 or to class 2 MHC, and as a result, irrespective of whether it binds to class 1 or class 2 MHC, you downregulate the CD8 co-receptor, and you get this type of cell. But when the signal persists, that is, when the T cell receptor is specific for class 2 MHC molecules, and it cooperates with the CD4 co-receptor, which is likewise specific for class 2 MHC molecules, then you generate a strong signal and you get a CD4 T cell. With this cell here, it's more complicated because it initially is CD4 plus 8 plus. It has the wrong phenotype. But then, under the influence of some cytokines, so he thinks IL-7 is important in this, there is what he calls co-receptor reversal. And then this cell, even though it receives only a weak signal, will end up as a cytotoxic T cell. When I first saw this paper, I thought this guy is absolutely crazy and there's not a chance in the world that this is true. But in the meantime, it has been shown that this is actually true. And people have done a much more detailed analysis and have found actually that when you have a double positive cell undergoing selection, at first will downregulate CD8 and will become a CD8 low cell, one of these intermediate. If the strong signal persists, it ends up as a CD4 T cell, whereas here this cell, which is CD8 low, will reverse and become a CD8 strong, 4 low cell, and finally become a CD8 cell. So the phenotypes of which Alfred Singer postulated are all there, but that is not sufficient He also, other people found that there are transcription factors which actually do exactly what he proposed. And that one of these transcription factors is called THPOC and was discovered by Dietmar Kakis in America. And sufficient to say that this THPOC transcription factor is responsible for making CD4 T cells under the influence of strong TCR signaling. So if you express this transcription factor independent of TCR signaling, all you get is CD4 T cells, because that overrides every signaling. And there is another transcription factor discovered by Dan Littman, which actually is responsible for making CD8 T cells. So without going through the experimental details, I can tell you that this scheme of Alfred Singer, which we initially thought was crazy and was too complicated, has been proven in most essential details to be correct and explain thymic selection as it occurs. So our transgenic mice initially set the stage for this discovery, and he then and other people discover in THPOC and other transcription factor like RANK3 were required to confirm his model of what positive selection, as it's called, or selection of CD4 cells and CD8 cells. And we think now we have a fairly complete understanding of these processes in the thymus, without which we would have a disaster. If all these cells came out and were just coming unselected to the periphery, we would suffer from autoimmune disease, and we would suffer from having inappropriate classes. So we would have CD8 cells helping B cells, and we would have CD4 cells killing B cells, which we don't want to have. So this thymic selection is absolutely essential for survival of the species, and I think we have now a fairly good molecular understanding of how it happens. And with that, I only want to go to, well, I also told you that when you have both the peptide ligand and the MHC, that you have negative selection, so these cells will be removed from the mature repertoire, and that explains at least in part tolerance, but it doesn't explain all the tolerance that we have. You should not be able to generate cells that attack self, because that would be self-defeating. And this brings me to the very last topic. I'm sorry, I will only take 2 more minutes. Of the generation of regulatory T cells, that these are cells that suppress immune responses. And their only function seems to be to suppress immune responses. And these cells are actually generated intrathymically and extrathymically. And they are generated intrathymically when you offer them a ligand to the T cell, a strong ligand to the T cell receptor. Then normally cells that will normally become CD4 T cells become CD4 T cells that express FOXP3, which is a specific transcription factor, and that transcription factor makes them suppressor T cells, so they will suppress ongoing immune responses. And all it takes is strong antigenic stimulation in the thymus, as shown here, where you, on the upper half you see CD25 positive cells. These are cells that express FOXP3. If you leave out the antigen, then you won't generate those cells, and you will generate only CD4 T cells. So, intrathymically, these cells are generated when you confront them with T cell receptor, strong T cell receptor ligands, then you may have actually some T cells with the same receptor that are regulatory T cells suppressing immune responses, and you may have CD4 T cells that do not express FOXP3, will have the same receptor and are effector T cells, but they will never mount an immune response because they are being held in check by the regulatory T cell. And so there is what is called an adaptation of the adaptive immune system, which is very sophisticated, and it happens mostly in the thymus. First, you have the stochastic generation of receptors, which include potentially dangerous receptors and dangerous combinations of CD4 expression and T cell receptor expression. But this is all sorted out by these selection mechanisms in the thymus, where you have positive selection that sorts out the CD4 cells, making cytokines being class 2 MHC restricted, and CD8 cells being cytolytic and class 1 MHC restricted, and the removal of cells that are potentially also reactive and could cause harm. Now, this negative selection in the thymus does appear to be complete, because you need these suppressor T cells in order to maintain animals autoimmune disease free. In other words, when you remove these regulatory T cells from the T cell repertoire, which can be done by certain tricks, then these animals will immediately develop autoimmune disease. So we are all being held in check by these regulatory T cells suppress immune responses against cells. That's an important consideration for these cells. And these cells probably will have an important role in preventing allergy and autoimmune diseases and other things. And they should be experimentally exploited. And so I want to finish here and just with the conclusion that it is a cellular selection in the adaptive immune system which makes sure that this immune system works properly, and that we all live without going through, most of us live without going through the problems of autoimmune disease and other immune diseases that are due to inappropriate selection of lymphocytes. And I want to finish here and leave you, and I hope you enjoy this beautiful afternoon. Thank you very much.